بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I hope the sound is working and is clear. If anybody can just confirm that the sound is moving properly, because I've got some weird icon showing up here, so I just want to make sure that the sound is coming up. Okay, sound is clear. Okay, perfect. Jazakallahu khair. All right, so we are doing the kitab known as I'la Us Sunan of Mulana Zafar Ahmad Thanvi or Uthmani Rahimahullah, because he is a Uthmani and a Thanvi. And we are dealing still with the broad chapter of Tahara. And tonight, inshallah, we have done so far 17 ahadith as far as the kitab itself is concerned, even though there were certain other ahadith that we had done in between which weren't exactly numbered. So tonight, inshallah ta'ala, we will be starting a new chapter, and it will be from our 18th hadith as far as the kitab goes. So this chapter is Bab Sunniyati al-Madmadati wal-Istinshaqi wa Tajdid al-Ma'i li kulli wahidin minhuma wal-Mubalaghatu fihi ma fi ghayri zamani sawm. The chapter with regards to rinsing the mouth and the nose in wudu, and that it is a sunnah to do so, and to take fresh water each time for the nose and each time for the mouth. And furthermore, another thing that's covered in these ahadith is وَالْمُبَالَغَةُ فِيهِمَا, to gargle deeply and draw water deeply into your nose when you are not fasting. And all of this will be explained in due course, inshallah. But let's start with our first hadith. So hadith number 18. عن أبي وائل شقيق بن سلمة رضي الله رحمه الله قال شهدت علي بن أبي طالب وعثمان بن عفان توضأ ثلاثا ثلاثا. Abu Wa'il Shaqiq ibn Salama, he said, I witnessed Hadhrat Ali ibn Abi Talib and Hadhrat Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu anhuma performing wudu. And they made wudu thalathan thalathan, meaning washing each lam thrice. وَأَفْرَدَ الْمَضْمَضَةُ مِنَ الْإِسْتِنْشَاقِ, and they separated rinsing the mouth from the nose. Now, how does this work, and what is the reason for mentioning this? Perhaps you may have come across and seen some people where they would scoop with their hand some water and take it from the bottom up. So they would put a little bit of water in their mouth and with that same handful go upwards and draw the remainder into their nose. So they would do it one handful for nose and mouth. And this is what is being said here, that this is not the correct way. So وَأَفْرَدَ, they sep afrada, which means in this case situation over here, to separate. They did it separate water for madmada, separate water for istinshaq. Madmada is gargling or rinsing the mouth. Istinshaq is the rinsing of the nose. So they use separate water for each of them. Thumma qala, then both Hazrat Ali and Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhuma had made the statement saying, hakada ra'ayna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tawadda'a. They said, this is how we saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performing wudu. Rawahu Abu Ali ibn Sakan fi sihahihi. This is reported by Imam Abu Ali ibn Sakan in his book of hadith. So what we are looking over here is that while some people may have this opinion of doing both nose and mouth in one go, we say you take a handful of water and you will put it in your mouth and you'll rinse your mouth, spit it out, another one in your mouth, spit it out, another one in your mouth, spit it out. You'll put, obviously, your at this point will come now your siwak or your finger, whichever one you are going to use, and then you will take water, pull into your nose and blow it out, and do so three times. But you will do them separate from one another, because we say the only thing we are interested in doing is following the sunnah. If something is established as being the sunnah, why would we have a problem with it? So we are, as the ahnaf, we follow the ahadith and we follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you can see it. We are not pulling things out of thin air. We have a hadith behind it, and we've got the amal of fuqaha of the sahaba behind it as well. So this is one such hadith that we have done on the topic. Let's move on further. He says, hadith number 19. سُئِلَ ابن أبي مُلَيْكَةَ عَنِ الْوُضُوءِ Ibn Abi Mulaika, he was asked with regards to wudu. Then he replied by saying, فَقَالَ رَأَيْتُ عُثْمَانَ بْنِ عَفَّانَ سُئِلَ عَنِ الْوُضُوءِ. He said, I saw Hazrat Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu being asked with regards to wudu. فَدَآ بِمَاءٍ فَأُتِيَ بِمِيضَأَةٍ. He called for some water and then he was brought بِمِيضَأَةٍ. مِيضَأَةٍ is a container from which people would make wudu. فَأَصْغَاهَا عَلَى يَدِهِ الْيُمْنَى. So he first poured some on his right hand. And we did this earlier in our previous classes, that you first wash your hands, thereafter you can put your hand into the container. So therefore, yeah, this is, and you know, this is one additional point. I mentioned it there, I'll mention it again, which is that you wash your hands before you put your hands into the container, irrespective of whether this be after you woke up or not. Because we know the hadith had mentioned that, when you wake up, إِذَا سَيْقَظَ أَحَدُكُم مِّن نَوْمِهِ فَلَا يَغْمِسَنَّ أَحَدُكُم, that when one of you wake up from sleep, then he should not take his غَمَسَ, he should not put his hand into the water until he has washed it, because لَا يَدْرِ أَيْنَ بَاتَتْ يَدُهُ, he don't know where his hand had spent the night. So we know that hadith in that context, but here we see that it was the habit. And Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu didn't do this for willy-nilly, you know, just for the sake of it. He did this because this is how he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing it. So he washed his hand, and it may mention ala yadihi al-yumna, that his right hand, because his right hand is the hand that he will be using, which tells you that this container that he was using for wudu was of a small size, and it was too narrow for two hands to be able to fit in at the same time. How do you come to a conclusion like this? Okay, but we're not talking about the historical perspective as to what the mida'a and things used to look like, but from the point is that he put one of his hands inside the container and he only washed his right hand. To show that, which you understand from the words of the narration, that there was not place for a person to have been able to put both hands in the container. Thus, it was sufficient for him to wash his right hand, because now he would dish water with that hand and wash his left hand and thereafter begin his wudu. So we come to, you know, it puts the picture in your mind that this container itself was small, and that it had a narrow opening at the top. Like our regular jugs today, you can't put both your hands in there and dish water out. If you're gonna dip your hands in, it's one thing, but to be able to dish water out with both hands, unless you get a wide mouth jug, you're not gonna get it happen. So, you know, you understand without it being said, without it being stated in so many words, but you come to realize that this was a small container with a narrowish sort of mouth. So anyway, ثم غسل يده اليمنى ثلاث. Okay, no, I skipped. Okay. ثم أدخلها في الماء. After having washed his right hand, he now put his hand into the water. فتمضمض ثلاثا. So he rinsed his mouth three times. In other words, put his hand in, took water, rinsed. Put his hand in, took water, rinsed. And rinsed his mouth three times. واستنثر ثلاثا. And blew his nose three times, each time taking fresh water. وغسل وجهه ثلاثا, and washed his face thrice. ثم غسل يده اليمنى ثلاثا وغسل يده اليسرى ثلاثا. Thereafter he washed his right hand, meaning right hand here is referring to وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ, your hand up until the elbow. So here your hand is being used in the meaning of arm. So he washed from his hand right up until above the elbows, as we say. So he washed his right arm three times, and thereafter he washed his left arm three times. ثم أدخل يده فأخذ ماء. Thereafter he put his hand into the container and he took some water. فمسح برأسه وأذنيه. Thereafter, with the water that he had taken out, he wiped his head and his ears. فغسل بطونهما وظهورهما مرة واحدة. And he washed his ear, بطونهما, هما, dual form. So this tells you, what is he washing here? His head and his ears? No, because then it would not used it in this fashion. So what is being meant is, he washed the inner parts and the outer parts of his ears once. And we know this from the method of wudu. Now, what you can see this image in your mind, Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu put the water in his hand, he brings it out, and obviously you if you happen to be using water from a jug and you are making wudu, you put one hand in, you pull out a hand full of water, you put your, you like, you cup your hands. Thus, the water transfers from hand number one into hand number two as well. So both hands become wet. And now you take this wet hands and you pass it over your head from the front where your hairline begins. Obviously, we're not talking about people with receding hairlines, but you start from the front right over till the back, and you know, al-udhunani min al-ra'as, as we know that hadith, that the ears are from the head. Thus, you know, the method is with your thumbs, you do the back of your ears, and then with your index finger, you will put him on the inside of your ears. So thus, you are washing the insides and the outsides. ظهورهما وبطونهما, both the outside and the inside of the ears, مرة واحدة, one time. In other words, with that one water that you had taken for your hair, which is taking from the front right through until the back of your nape. And obviously, from the narration which we have passed by, or maybe that was in my other class, but any case, the wiping of the nape, the back of the neck in wudu, is from the sunnah as well, even though some may deem it as being mustahab or and stuff like this here. But anyway, okay, when does the masah of the hands come in? Masah of the hands, masah of the hands? Or do you mean the khilal of the fingers? Because we have washing of the hands, khilal is something separate. Okay, with regards to the khilal of the fingers, khilal of the fingers comes during the time when you are now washing, when it comes to وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ, and washing the arms up until the elbows. Now, what has happened over here? Yes, obviously, if you're looking at this narration over here, it did not make mention specifically about khilal of the fingers. When you come to the actual chapter with regards to khilal, other ahadith will be quoted. I mean, this hadith did not make mention of an intention. This hadith did not make mention of many, many different things. Like, for example, it didn't make mention of a siwak. It didn't make mention of using a finger, even though we passed by previous ahadith where those things were mentioned. So sometimes a narration does not necessarily mention everything. So this is one such narration. So the making the khilal of the fingers come when you are washing your arms. When you wash your right arm, you make the khilal of your fingers. When you wash your left arm, you make the khilal of that one's fingers. That's how it is done. Even though some will say you wash both arms and then you make khilal of the fingers of both hands. But anyway, be that as it may, the khilal of the fingers come in at the point after you have washed your arms. Wallahu a'lam. Anyway, so we came on now. I forgot what I was mentioning with regard. Okay, we were dealing with the washing of the ears. ثُمَّ غَسَلَ رِجْلَيْهِ. Thereafter, he washed his two feet. ثُمَّ قَالَ أَيْنَ السَّائِلُونَ عَنِ الْوُضُوءِ. Then Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu, he called out, or at least Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhu, he called out and he said, where is those questioners, those people who asked with regards to the wudu? Obviously, the question came forward, and then Hazrat Uthman radiyallahu anhu, he said, هَكَذَا رَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَتَوَضَّعُ رَوَاهُ أَبُو دَاوُدُ وَسَكَتَ عَنُهُ هُوَ وَالْحَافِظُ الْمُنذِرِ وَفِي التَّلْخِيصُ الْحَبِيرُ وَهُوَ ظَاهِرٌ فِي الْفَصْلِ وَفِي آثَارِ سُنَنْ إِسْنَادُهُ صَحِيحٌ. So he said, this is how I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam performing wudu. Now, time and again, like I mentioned just a moment ago, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam on occasion wiped one time, on occasion wiped two times, on occasion wiped three times. So therefore, you find various ahadith about wiping X amount and stuff like this. So therefore, on one occasion, and Hazrat Uthman radiallahu anhu performed wudu for the tabi'in many times. This was on one occasion where he did it in this fashion. As you know, the famous hadith on wudu of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu anhu have slight changes in from this narration here. So, you know, on one occasion, she showed it this way, on another occasion, he showed it that way, both of which are from the sunnah. Any case, Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah reported this hadith wasakata anhu, and he kept silent. Now we know the usul of Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah is that when he quotes a hadith and he does not comment on it, that means he regards the hadith as being authentic. Now Hafiz Imam Al-Mundhiri rahimahullah, the author of At-Targhib wa Tarhib, he also kept silent on this, and that is his approval as well, because he would comment if he regarded it as not being authentic. But the fact that he kept silent means that he regards it to be authentic. So the muhaddith who recorded the hadith deemed it as being authentic. Hafiz al-Mundhiri, who's a hafiz al-hadith, he deemed it as being authentic. Talkhis al-Habir is written by Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah. He says, wa zahirun fil fasl. This hadith is quite, on the topic of wudu, you don't even need to explain it. Everything is quite self-explanatory. But anyway, he says, وَفِي آثَارِ السُّنَنِ, in the book known as آثَارُ السُّنَنِ, it's mentioned إِسْنَادُهُ صَحِيح, that the chain of narration with regards to this hadith is authentic. So we are more than satisfied that this is the way that a person makes wudu, washing the mouth separately and the nose separately, I mean taking fresh water each time, not using the same water for both of them. All right, so that was the 19th hadith. Let's move on further. وقال أبو بشر الدولابي فيما جمعه من حديث الثوري حدثنا محمد بن بشار أخبرنا ابن مهدي عن سفيان عن أبي هاشم عن عاصم بن لقيط عن أبيه لقيط عن النبي صلى الله رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا توضأت فأبلغ في المضمضة والاستنشاق إلا أن تكون صائما. قال أبو الحسين أو أبو الحسن ابن القطان هذا صحيح. Alright, next hadith is reported, it's Abu Bishr al-Dulabi, what he gathered from the ahadith of Imam al-Thawri. He said, Muhammad ibn Bashar narrates from Ibn Mahdi, from Imam Sufyan, from Abu Hashim, from Asim ibn Laqit, who narrates from his father, Hadrat Laqit, radiyallahu anhu, from Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who said, إِذَا تَوَضَّأَتَ فَأَبْلِغْ فِي الْمَضْمَضَةِ وَالْإِسْتِنْشَاقِ. That when you make wudu, فَأَبْلِغْ فَبَالِغْ, in the narration of Imam ibn Hibban, rahimahullah, فَبَالِغْ فِي الْإِسْتِنْشَاقِ, is what that narration mentions. Now this one, the reason he quoted this one is فَأَبْلِغْ فِي الْمَضْمَضَةِ وَالْإِسْتِنْشَاقِ. This one points out both the rinsing of the mouth and the nose. So this hadith serves two purposes. The first is to tell us that when we are making wudu, don't just wet your tongue or your lips here and you say, well, I washed a bit of my mouth. No, you must pull the or at least you put water in your mouth and rinse it properly. Gargle as well. Obviously, don't put it such that you gag and choke and kill yourself there while you're making wudu. Nobody asks for that. And likewise, while istinshaq, which is to draw water into your nose, so draw water deeply into your nose at normal times. Don't now pull it that the water goes up into your brain and you fall. Nobody asks for extremes, but fabaligh, faabligh, that pull it deeply to the best of your capability. That's what you should do. And then this is where the second part of the hadith comes in. إِلَّا أَن تَكُونَ صَائِمًا, except if you are fasting. Now, what is the reason for pointing out this part of except if you are fasting? And this is where our Hanafi dalil comes in. We say that if a person is making wudu and he draws the water deeply into his nose or into his mouth, and you know, if you are drawing it deeply, what happens? It's more than likely something's going to go down. The water goes beyond the soft part of your nose and it ends up going down your throat. Your fast breaks. You are rinsing, now you're gargling your mouth and something slips down your throat. Your fast breaks, as far as the Hanafi madhab is concerned. Now, one point of clarification over here, that rinsing your mouth in wudu is one thing. When you spat the water out, you will feel a bit of wetness still in your mouth. That does not affect your fast. What affects your fast is when the actual water itself, a part of it goes down your throat. That breaks your fast. So we say, this hadith is our dalil from the Hanafi madhab for us to say that it breaks your fast. Otherwise, what is there a need for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to specifically point out that don't do so if you are fasting? If it doesn't affect your fast, then it's neither here nor there. But if it affects your fast, then there's a need to mention that don't do this if you are fasting. Because in other words, if you do this while you are fasting, it can go down your throat and thus it can break your fast. Therefore, we say, when you are fasting, don't pull the water deeply into your nose. Don't lay your head back and gargle your mouth while you are fasting. Now, some people, they tend to get a little bit trouble in this regard because, you know, they used to throw their head back, throw a full mouth and gargle like this here. Now they scared, should I just leave it out altogether when making wudu? No. If you are afraid that even the least bit that you do is going to let something go down your throat or up your nose and down your throat that way, then in that case, yes. Rather, you give precedence to the preservation of your fast than giving to the sunnah of washing your, rinsing your mouth and your nose. if you know you are unable to do it, then you will skip them and just make your wudu excluding them. But the way that I normally tell people that when you are making your wudu and you are fasting, don't tilt your head back. In fact, tilt your head forward when you rinse your mouth while fasting, because that way there is no way that the water can go down your throat unless you are literally swallowing it yourself. It can't go back. Your head is tilted forward. It's the laws of gravity is forcing the water out of your mouth and not down towards your throat. Therefore, you rinse your mouth in that way, and you know for certain you are quite safe. The water is not going to go down. And likewise, when it comes to the water in your nose, you put the water in your hand and you take it only till the front portion of your nose that you can. Don't try and pull it deeply up into your nose. You know, if you've ever pulled water into your nose, you know that little bit, you just pull a little and that will reach the front part of your nose, or at least it will go into your nose, but you're not going to, and you know, say, oh, oops, the water all came in, went down and came down my throat. Then, you know, it's a bit of a problem. Now, there's one thing that makes it this can save a person's fast. Forgetfulness of fasting saves your fast. While being aware of fasting and you do something which breaks your fast unintentionally, it still breaks it. So if, let's put it this way, simply put, I've digressed a bit, but anyway, when you are making your wudu and you are aware, I am fasting, and now unintentionally water goes down your throat, your fast is broken. That's scenario A. Scenario B, you are performing your wudu and you forget, you know, it's like it's the early days of Ramadan. You forgot, you don't even remember that you're fasting. So you're so used to putting water deeply in your nose. So you put the water deeply in and in your throat and it goes down. And now you realize, I'm fasting. In this situation here, your fast is intact. Why? Because forgetfulness is an excuse as far as fasting is concerned, but doing something intentionally, albeit unintentionally, let's say, or at least doing it with presence of mind that I'm you are aware you're fasting, is different from a person who's doing something while forgetting the fact that he is fasting. Anyhow, so I've digressed a bit from the topic, but anyway, that was just to touch on the point of why we don't pull the water deeply in our nose and mouth while fasting. Now, Imam Abu Hussein or Abu Hassan ibn al-Qattan, he said, "Hada sahihun, this is sahih, this hadith is authentic, this is the way that it's supposed to be." This is mentioned in Nailul Awtar of Imam Ashokani, rahimahullah. Let's see if we can, how much more we can do. Okay, we've got basically one last hadith, so let's finish the chapter off, which is عن عمر بن يحيى المازني عن أبيه أن رجلا قال لعبد الله بن زيد وهو جد عمر بن يحيى أتستطيع أن تريني كيف كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتوضأ. So Amr ibn Yahya al-Mazini narrates from his father that a man said to Abdullah ibn Zayd, who is the grandfather of Hadrat, or at least the grandfather of Amr ibn Yahya, the narrator Amr ibn Yahya al-Mazini, his grandfather is Hadrat Abdullah ibn Zayd, radiyallahu anhu. So this man came to him and asked him, "Are you able to show me how did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam perform wudu?" فقال عبد الله بن زيد نعم. So حضرت عبد الله بن زيد رضي الله عنه, he said yes. فدعا بماء, so he called for some water. فأفرغ على يده فغسل يده, so he poured some water over his hand. And what we understand automatically is that this hand, على يده, his hand would mean his right hand. فغسل يده مرتين, he washed his hand twice. ثم مضمض واستنثر ثلاثا, thereafter he rinsed his mouth and he rinsed his nose or blew his nose thrice. So rinsed his mouth three times, blew his nose three times. ثم غسل وجهه ثلاثا, thereafter he washed his face three times. ثم غسل يديه مرتين مرتين الى المرفقين, thereafter he washed his hands twice, each arm twice up until the elbow. So here, this hadith of Hadhrat Abdullah ibn Zayd showing a method of wudu of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but different to that of the previous one of Hadhrat Ali and Hadhrat Uthman radiyallahu anhumah. So here in this instance, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam washed his face three times, but then washed his arms twice only. ثم مسح رأسه بيديه. Thereafter, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wiped his head with his hands, with both his hands. فأقبل بهما وأدبر. بدأ بمقدم رأسه حتى ذهب بهما إلى قفاه. That Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam used both his hands to make a full head wipe. So فأقبل بهما وأدبر. Came from the front to the back and back to the front. بدأ بمقدم رأسه. He started from the front of the hair, you know, like we say, from where the hair starts. حتى ذهب بهما إلى قفاه. And thereafter, they took it right to the back, إلى قفاه, to his nape, till where the hair ends, till the nape. ثم ردهما إلى المكان الذي بدأ منه. Thereafter, in other words, if you are picturing the scene, or you can do it yourself virtually, take your hands, put it on your head, wipe it over to the back of your neck, and then bring your hands back up to the front of your head where you had begun from. ثم غسل رجليه. Thereafter, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or at least Hazrat Abdullah ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu, washed his feet, and he ended it this way because this was the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had made wudu. Rawahu al-Bukhari. Obviously, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah reports this hadith, so you know it's an authentic hadith as well. So what did this hadith is shown that was different from the previous is that, like I mentioned, on occasion Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sometimes washed parts thrice, sometimes twice, sometimes even once. Thrice is the best way, the sunnah. All three would count as being sunnah, but the best way is to do it three times. If you are short on water, let's say for example you happen to have a little glass of water that you have, a 200 ml bottle of water that you've got with you. Obviously, you know, if you have to do the whole wudu, washing each limb thrice, you're going to run out of water. So in a situation like this here, you use the little water, and if it means you wash each limb once, then you do it once. If it means you can get two comfortably, then you take them twice. Obviously, if you can do three, you do three, but it comes according to your need. But if you, even if you didn't have a need and you do it twice, it would not be a problem, because this was also one way that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed wudu. So that was the end of that chapter. We've run basically our time up. The next chapter continues on Babu Ifrad al-Madmadati min al-Istinshaqi, the chapter with regards to separating madmada from istinshaq. But inshallah ta'ala, we'll do that next time. As you can see, there's some ahadith couple in this chapter. Then we come to wiping the ears with the water of the head. Like I say, I explained it now in a brief form a moment ago. But anyway, we'll do all of these things inshallah ta'ala, and then khilal, takhlil of the beard, and then takhlil al-asabi'i wa dalk al-a'adha, the takhlil khilal question that was queried earlier. So these things are all still coming. But inshallah ta'ala, we'll get to all of them in due course. It won't take us too long. Hopefully next week inshallah ta'ala, we can finish this whole chapter with madmada and the wiping of the ears as well, and possibly even do a part on the some of these narrations are a bit on the long side, but we'll see how far we go inshallah. But anyway, that being that, we are ending for tonight inshallah ta'ala. If anybody has any questions, you're more than welcome to ask your questions. Okay, don't seem to have any questions over here. Anyway, so then we'll end on this point here, inshallah ta'ala. We'll start again on Monday once more, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, with the tafsir class. But until then, we will end for now. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.